public, perhaps an opening in my life. For the next 9 years, I lived on this earth and did not leave it until December 23rd of the year 2000. Now, there are those of you who knew me when I was alive. My friends called me Bill, and some people say, I knew you, Bill. I was Bill Doerflinger. And I was not Bill Doerflinger. Well, let me tell you something. Death changes people. I'm different today. In fact, I'm not the man I used to be. And that has some benefits. I was able to meet my mother-in-law on the other side. Her name was Louise Homer. She was the star of the Metropolitan Opera back in the last century and sang with Enrico Caruso. And so knowing what goes on the other side, I asked her if she'd give me some voice lessons because I wanted to join the Heavenly Choir. And she agreed. She said I'd give you a tough case, but you were to have it. And I succeeded, and now I'm in the bass section of the Heavenly Choir. And every once in a while, I run into some old snubs up there, people I had met down here on Earth, from whom I collected the music, and I joined right in with them on the chorus because, as people who knew me when I was here, I wasn't much of a singer, although I loved the song, another thing, I grew a beard. My goodness, it seems that every barber on the other side is alive. You can find scissors every once in a while, but the razors were almost unheard of in size. That's why so many men up there walk around with beards. I think it gives you a more celestial look. But that's enough about my afterlife. I came here to talk about my former life and to give you an idea of who I was and how it happened that I came here. I like the wonderful song that we're all here celebrating today. My family lived here on Staten Island, first on Figureboard Road, and then finally on Ward Avenue, with another place that Bob Wright will tell you about when he comes on, because that's his special role that he was on today. But in all of that time, I lived near the ocean, near the small corner. We lived here during the year, and in the summer we went out to Huntington, Long Island, near the Long Island Sound, and we summered there. So over the years, I developed this affection for salt water and all things connected to it, including songs of the sea. I'm not sure exactly when it was that I became infatuated with them, but it's a fact that I did. I attended the Staten Island Academy, and upon graduating from there, I enrolled in Princeton. And where would a young man who was on Bard Avenue, what major would he have at Princeton, of course? Yes, that's the thing. I didn't have many choices living on Bard Avenue. It was the summer of before my senior year in 1930. I was up in Nova Scotia visiting friends. And I was faced with the prospect of having to do a senior dissertation that year. And I don't know what it was about romance, exoticism, inspiration that the coast of maritime provinces had, and wild woods up there. But it was at that time that I decided I would use for my dissertation a collection of sea songs. So I got on a bus on Digby Neck, headed into the Bay of Fundy, and the bus driver recognized that I was not the usual the customer of his, that I was expected for the area, and asked me what I was about. And I told him I was looking for some old sailors, or any kind of sailors, who knew old songs and would share them with me. Well, upon saying that to the bus driver, he let out with an old sea song. It turned out that his father had been a sea captain of a ship, and he gave me a song. So I said, this is very encouraging. They say you have to be in the right place to collect these kinds of songs. And at that time, in 1930 in the summer, in Nova Scotia, I was in the right place. might say, why is it that with subpar right in his backyard, he didn't have the idea to do this there? Well, it just so happened it was in my backyard. Before we get into how I got here, let me just tell you a couple more things about it. The dissertation that I have for my senior year, I don't know if it inspired me. I know it may be compulsive, but it certainly raised the passion in me. So I continued on with my studies in English because, you know, at that time, anything connected with folklore or ballads was the domain of the English departments. Just 3 years before I had gone to Nova Scotia, I saw that Carl Sandburg had published a book, The American Songbook, his collection of songs from the Midwest. And for many years before that, an English professor at Harvard by the name of Hendricks was encouraging his students and also members of the American Folklore Society to go out into the field and to collect these. He was developing systems for the collection of this music. And they were to go out there and collect both the words and the music. Of course, recording devices weren't always available, so they had to figure out a way after notation to write down the notes of these songs. And he said it was their job to go out there and get them while they were still there to be captured. Now, I don't know if either of these things, Sandburg's American Songwriting or Hendricks's admonitions to his students, had anything to do with my decision. But you could say that if you were in the English department of a place like Princeton, that folklore and folk music was in the air, and the collection of these things was a natural thing to do, and something that one might expect if you're a professor as a paper, a term paper, a dissertation, whatever you want to call it. So I continued with this through my master's degree, Princeton, which I received the following year, and it was such an obsession with me that I continued on at Harvard, where I received a PhD, continuing my studies in this area, which as a dissertation, my doctoral dissertation, eventually wound up as Shantymen and Shanty Boys, published in 1951, which later was published as the book we know today, Songs of the Sailor and Loverman. But back to Nova Scotia. I'm home to Staten Island. I live on Bar Avenue, practically across the street. And sometime it occurred to me that there is treasure here in my backyard. What was I looking for up in Nova Scotia? I was looking for old sailors, people who could sing the old songs. I didn't realize that this old men's home in the neighborhood was filled with people like this. It hadn't occurred to me that the material I was traveling so far afield to collect was right here, virtually on my nose. So at that point, I decided to visit the place. And they told me, the man you want to see is Richard Maitland, affectionately known as Captain Dick. So I went over to Tara, and I went to see Captain Dick.
Captain Dick!
Ah, Captain Dick is here!
Oh, sir, fine, my God!
You remember you swaying back and forth today, and you sort of lost me balance there.
Well, the reason for being so familiar with you, sir, my name is Bill Doerflinger. I live in the neighborhood.
William Doerflinger. I never tell you that in the air.
Well, actually, this is my first time here. I'm collecting. I'm collecting songs from the sea. I hear you're the man to see about hearing some of them, letting you know what they are and kind of stories that go with them. Would you be willing to do that and help me?
Well, I'll give it a try. It's been quite a while, and you certainly may.
Thank you.
It's been quite a while since I've been at sea. You know, by God, being in the old folks' home, you know, with a lot of old folks, I'm becoming a little feeble and old myself. But we'll give it a try.
Sure. I understand some of them you used for your work.
Yes, they're called sea shanties. Shanties. Yes. Shanties were never used for pleasure, only for work. Yes. And you can see that this establishment is full of working people. We don't lay around too much. Well, sea shanties. Why? Let me tell you, sea shanties are so you all pull together and multiply the power, and that you all get together on the line. I'll give you an example or two. I'll give you a howling shanty, and then maybe songs that were sung for pleasure, or watch, shanties were never sung for pleasure, only for work. Thank God.
But you sing one for me now, won't you?
Well, let me see. I'll give you a topsail halyard shanty. Topsail, in the beginning of the 19th century, they were large sails. I'll tell you, they were cumbersome. And as the ships grew bigger, so did the sails. And these sails got so big that they were pretty hard to handle. So what did the shipyards do and the engineers there with their drafting? They took the topsail and they split it in half horizontally, and they called the lower part the lower topsail, and the top part is the upper topsail. Now, sails are mounted on the yards. There was never any problem setting lower topsails because they were bound to the mast. The mast was a permanent fixture. It did not move. The sailors went up the mast, out on the yards, and they cast off the gaskets that held the sails to the yard, and the sails, by their own weight, dropped down. No problem. Wasn't too much work there, let me tell you.
You didn't have to sing a song for that, did you?
No, but that's only half the sail.
Right.
When they wanted to set the upper topsail, now you are not only pulling on the weight for the yard to go up, but the weight of the sail is also on the yard. So that's a heavy task, and the four boys had to pull together in unison. So we'll give you a upper topsail shanty called Blow Boys Blow. It refers to the slaving trade down along Africa. And it goes something like this. Well, first of all, how do we get to this yard? Attached to the yard is a rope that goes through blocks and pulleys, and it comes down to the deck, and now it goes to another pulley block, and horizontally the crew who is pulling on the ropes, because if I am shantyman, I can't raise the weight of the mast and the sails also. So this is a problem. So we get part of the crew, and they're going to string out along the deck, and this here rope from the upper yard comes down through pulleys and horizontally across the deck. And when I grab the halyard and pull, the lads are pulling along the deck. So it's like 90 degree angle here. And doesn't go something like this, it goes exactly like this. Let me see. You lads, you ready?
I'm ready. Since I'm a young fellow, I can do this.
Well, I'm not as young as you are then. I'm giving it over.
Well, I've got to watch the master again. Right.
Well, it's been a couple of years since I've been at sea, so let us pretend that this is a ship, and this is a packet ship, and this happens to be the Dreadnought, which was a famous packet ship between Liverpool and New York.
Ah, will you ever on the Congo be back?
No, boy, no.
That fever makes the white man shiver.
No, he wouldn't
fly. My empty ship came down the river.
No, boy, no.
My empty ship came down the river.
No, he
like that, so I will give you a couple lines of the song, because this is, takes a lot out of you. This is, each year, Madison George must weigh 2,000 pounds, and so, as I say, it's a lot of work.
How do you know she's a clapper?
Low, always low.
The stars and stripes stream up behind her.
Low, equally, boys, low.
Today and blow tomorrow.
Blow, boys, blow.
I'll blow away all care and sorrow.
Blow me, bully boys, blow.
Aye, and up comes the arrow packet.
Blow, boys, blow.
She fired her guns, can you hear the racket?
Blow me, bully boys, blow.
And then you wrap the rope around the bleeding pin, which is quickly released when you need it. These blame pins are assigned ropes to all the sailors above. Some of them come down to the side of the hull and they're attached. Some come straight down. They're for the clues, and they adjust the sails once the sails are dropped. So once you get the yard up, the sailors got to go up on the yard and go out and loosen the sails on the top mast gallant. And well, the gallant sails are above the top sails. And it doesn't matter if you are on the main mast, the foremast, the mizzen mast, you've got the sails set the same way. And you do the same work. And by God, we get the sails and the ship moving.
I'm tired already.
Aye, my God, I'm through that.
Yeah. Do you know any other song?
Well, you know, after you do all of this work, you sort of go below or go up on the forecastle and sing recreational songs, such as I said that this might be the Dreadnought. The Dreadnought was a fantastic packet ship that ruled the waves between Liverpool and New York. It was called the Liverpool Packet. Though she belonged to New York and shipped out of New York, anybody wanting to cross the Atlantic to Liverpool would try to get on passage on the Dreadnought. She was such a fine, well-run ship, and the sailors were proud to be sailors on the Dreadnought.
There's a saucy flash packet to fame. She hails from New York and the Dreadnought's her name. Out around that rock light where the salt winds do blow. Bound away in the Dreadnought to the westward we'll go.
Derry down, 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 derry down.
And the lasses to the pier the head do flop. They give three cheers as the tears down do flow. She's the Liverpool packet, oh Lord, let her go.
Derry down, 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 derry down.
Derry down,
down, down, derry down.
What a crew we got here.
And now she's a sail in the wild Irish Sea. Her passengers merry, their hearts full of glee. Her sailors like lions walk the decks to and fro. She's the Liverpool packet, oh Lord, let her go.
Derry down, 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 derry down, derry down, 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 derry down.
Now the Dreadnought's a sailing the wild, the long,
Now the dreadnoughts are sailing the wild Atlantic, with deep rolling seas roll along her black sides, with a mainsail set for the red cross to show. She's the Liverpool packet, oh Lord, let her go.
Derry down, 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 derry down, derry down, 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 derry down.
Now the dreadnoughts are sailing the banks of Newfoundland, where the bottom's all green and the bottom's all sand, where the fishes of the ocean they swim to and fro. She's the Liverpool packet, oh Lord, let her go.
Derry down, 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 derry down, derry down, 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 derry down.
Now the dreadnoughts are sailing the Long Island shore, with a pilot well aboard her, as we often before, laying you to gallants your mainsail drops so. She's the Liverpool packet, oh Lord, let her go.
Derry down, 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 derry down, derry down, 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 derry down.
Now the dreadnoughts arrived at South Street once more, so go ashore, shipmates, to the gals you adore, with your wives and your sweethearts, how merry you'll be. Drink the health to the dreadnought, where'er she may be.
Derry down, 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 derry down, derry down, 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 derry down.
Now hail to the dreadnought and all of her crew, and the old Captain Samuels and his officers too. You can keep your flesh packets, swallowtail and black ball. The dreadnoughts, the flyer that outsailed them all.
Derry down, 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 derry down, derry down, 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 derry down.
I know it's only me and you in this room, but I hear Scully singing. I hear response to my choruses. This is it. You're back from the dead, and so are these here.
I'm getting confused, but before I get more confused, do you have any other thoughts?
Well, I'd like to put it...
You can take a drink of water first.
This is your water, sir. Sir, so, you want to see my tattoos on my hairy chest? No water for me.
They told me that the sailors only drink water here, retirees, because if they would try anything else, they may find another, they have to go to another place to live. So I will not tell anyone that this is anything but water.
Thank you, sir.
You're very welcome.
You're gentle to us.
Well, I'm not an experienced boy.
I sort of got another song about the sailors, because over the decades from the American Revolution, these ships got bigger and faster, and after a while, they couldn't supply enough crews. Back in the colonial days, the towns, Boston and Newport, all supplied sailors, but they were all related. They were cousins, uncles, and fathers, and but when these packet ships started crossing the Atlantic on a steady run, there was more and more packet ships. Where are they going to get sailors? Well, by God, other nationalities came in, and I hate to tell you this, but they scraped the bottom of the barrel on some of these Liverpool ships, and what manned these here ships were called packet rats, because they were the lowest of the low. But they were exceptional sailors. Let me tell you, at sea, they were fine, fine sailors. But when they got ashore, they sort of deteriorated quickly between the booze and the women and, oh my God. Well, these ships were supplied by a system called trimming. It lasted about right up to the end of sail, and where they would sort of hijack you and Shanghai you, whether you wanted to go to sea or not. Some of these farm boys would come down looking for a good time at seaports, of course. That's where the young ladies were, and the booze. The farm was good enough for them when they were younger, but when they got to these here seaports, the crimps and the boarding house masters would take these fellas in free, feed them, give them a room, let them drink every night, and they said, this is a fantastic life. Little did they know, the boarding house master was also sort of a shipping agent, along with being a school teacher, because if you supplied the captains with real sailors, they would be paid more than if you were a landlubber that went to sea. So this here fellow, Paddy West, was a boarding house master, and when a ship needed a couple men, Paddy West would offer his students as sailors. Little did the captain know that these people learned the hard way. And I'm going to sing a song that tells you what they learned in their maritime school. I think I got a musical instrument here in the seaweed, and the salt air didn't corrode it. I got, of course, these things. This is a concertina. There were not many concertinas that went to sea, although the concertina was developed about 1838 or something like that. Mostly, if they had musical instruments, they had German accordions because they were cheaper. These were much more expensive, and after a couple weeks at sea, they started falling apart.
You have the expensive one, don't you?
Well, I avoided Paddy West boarding houses, and I saved the money, and I avoided the women, and I didn't drink as much as I do now. This is called Paddy West.
Says to me, that's fine.
Now, when they ask if you've been to sea, you can say across the line.
Take off your dungaree jackets and give yourselves a rest, and we'll think of them all the westerns that we have at best.
You don't have to be a sailor to know crossing the line is crossing the equator from the north hemisphere into the southern hemisphere. And since I'm explaining this, maybe I should say, when we get to the boat's horn on the table, they ask if the captain asks you if you've ever been to sea, you can say you've been around the horn, meaning in Cape Horn, but the sailor would mean, yeah, the horn on the table.
Ah, Paddy Pike, this way from deck, this patience for command. His wife, she stood in the doorway with a bucket in her hand. Now Paddy sung out, now let her rip, and she threw the water away, saying, blew up your port, the gansel boys, she's taking on the spray. Take off your dungaree jackets and give yourselves a rest, and we'll think of the whole of westerns that we have blessed.
Now there's just one thing for you to do before you sail away. That's to step around the table where the bullet's home you lay. Now when they ask if you've been to sea, you can say,
10 times rabble.
Hey, Jesus, you're an old sailor lad since the day that you were born.
Put on your dungaree jacket.
Captain Maitland, this was wonderful. What a wonderful.
I thought you were going to call me Dick because I'm just like you there, Bill.
No, I'm the young fella, so I have the respect for you, an older gentleman.
Well, it is true, I'm getting old, by God, you know.
Now, you could even call me Billy if you wanted to.
Billy.
Even though my name is Bill.
Billy. Okay, you can call me Dickie. No, well, no. Captain Dick.
Captain
Maitland.
I have a recording machine in my home.
I
live very close by over on Warren Avenue here. Would you be willing to come to my house so I could record some of these stories and songs?
Well, I would be pleased with that. They would take me back to my youth and sailing these ships and my crew members and all of these great songs.
Thank you.
Okay, Bill. Billy.
Billy.
Right, here you go.
Maitland and a lot of other sailors, both here in Snug Harbor and up and down the northeast coast, and from that I made my collection. And we did have recording equipment at my home. In fact, the Library of Congress took an interest in my work and they lent me their own recording equipment in 1942, and it was in my home with that equipment that I recorded Captain Patrick Taylor. My life up until 1950s was pretty much involved with the collection and the editing of these songs, with the exception of a few years during World War II, when I was taken into the service of the Allied forces and worked in the psychological warfare section of the Allied forces in Africa, Italy, and France. Even at this late stage of my post-life, I can't discuss anything about what I did. But after returning from World War II, I resumed my career in publishing with the Macmillan Company, later with E.P. Dutton, and I stayed as a publisher most of my life. One other thing that I had that was rather unusual, I was an amateur magician, and I had an interest in magic. I wrote a book about magic, and I was a long, long time member of the International Brotherhood of Magicians, which may explain my appearance here tonight. I want to thank you for your attention, and hope you have some sort of a sense of what it took to get this and the great treasure we had here, right on Staten Island, with the sailors' snug harbor and the snugs that we had. Goodbye.